Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Palm Sunday service. It's lovely to see you all, and if you're joining us online, welcome, and we hope that you will enjoy the message that's brought to us this morning. The prayer calendar, if any of you don't have one, please speak to us at the end of the service so that we can give you one of these, and if there isn't any out there left, we'll definitely make sure you get some sent to you or given to you next week. On Monday, the prayer meeting in the hall is at 11 o'clock for anyone that wants to come along. It's a kind of busy week this week because it's Holy Week. Thursday is Maundy Thursday, and we'll have a communion service here at 7:30. On Friday, there's an Easter walk, which we had before, walking past all the churches and then going to the station and having a short service. Don't have any information as yet what time this is going to happen. After that, the church will be open for contemplation of the seven sayings of Jesus on the cross from 12 till 3. There'll be tea and coffee. You can go in and out and help yourselves. So that should be a long day, but it'll be an interesting day. Next week, we have Stuart coming and taking the service on Easter Sunday. This morning, we have Brian with us, but before Brian takes over the service, Stuart wants to say a few words.
Thank you very much, Eunice. It's really just to say about the two special services. We've got two very special events coming up this week. The two most moving and significant events in the Christian calendar, Maundy Thursday and Good Friday. On Maundy Thursday, we'll reflect on the events in the upper room when Jesus changed the centuries-old Passover into what we now call communion. Before the service, starts at 7:30, but before that service, there will be tea and coffee if you can come early or would like to chat with people. We'll just leave after the service, which will be about 8:30. On Good Friday, it went dark from 12 noon to 3 p.m. Our Saviour was bearing our sins. This is a very solemn, and it's at the very heart of our faith. Good Friday services can be very encouraging and enriching spiritually. In my memory, in different churches, they've been some of the high points of my Christian life from a public point of view. We'll have traditional hymns, mostly. I think the youngest will be about 40 years old, but normally they'll be in the 18th century, John Wesley and the likes of that. In the New Testament, in John's Gospel, it says, because the Passover was coming on the Sabbath, then it was a great Sabbath. And in one translation, it says, it was a high and holy Sabbath, a special one. That's what I think we should think of Good Friday, a high and holy Sabbath, the most holy day and the holy few hours of our Christian faith when Jesus was our Saviour. We'll be here at 12. Tea and coffee will be available throughout till 3. These were the hours that Jesus was on the cross when it was dark. Don't feel that you have to commit to the whole 3 hours. You can come for as long as you're able and then slip out quietly. It'll be informal. We'll be at the front here in a horseshoe shape. And I think if you do come, you won't want to leave, because you'll be saying, the Lord is in this place and it is good. Jesus' disciples, one last thing, practiced fasting. On 3 occasions, he said to them, when you fast, do this or don't do that. So they obviously did fast to some extent. if you're not in the habit of fasting, then Good Friday, at least until 3 o'clock, would be a good discipline. It does concentrate the mind. It does make the day a bit different and special. So be careful if you've any medical condition, like diabetes, because you don't want your blood sugar to go too low. But if it's medically practical, then you could just have fluids until you get home. And I think that will help. We hear a lot about Ramadan and Muslims fasting, but we can fast occasionally. And Good Friday is a good day to do it. So please come along Thursday and Friday, because there is blessing there for us all to be part of. Thank you. Welcome, Brian.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you, Stuart, and thank you once again for your invitation and for your welcome here today. This is again one of those special Sundays, Palm Sunday, when we think about Jesus in terms of his kingship. Think of Jesus as our king. So I wanted to read a few verses from 1 Samuel, where we're told this. When Samuel grew old, he appointed his sons as judges for Israel. The name of his firstborn was Joel, and the name of his second was Abijah, and they served at Beersheba. But his sons did not walk in his ways. They turned aside after dishonest gain and accepted bribes and perverted justice. So all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah. They said to him, "You are old, your sons do not walk in your ways. Now appoint a king to lead us, such as all the other nations have." But when they said, "Give us a king to lead us," this displeased Samuel. So he prayed to the Lord. And the Lord told him, "Listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you they have rejected, but they have rejected me as their king, as they have done from the day I brought them up out of Egypt until this day, forsaking me and serving other gods. So they are doing to you. Now listen to them, but warn them solemnly and let them know what the king who will reign over them will do." He asked for another king. Today is our opportunity to remember and to declare who is our king, and that is Jesus and him alone. We're going to sing together. Hosanna, loud Hosanna. We'll stand as we sing. before we pray together, let me give you your daily dose of Hebrew. Because I was reading a Hebrew scholar, and he says that we should not pronounce the word Hosanna, but Hoshiana. Doesn't quite fit with the singing, however. But that's apparently how it should be pronounced, not Hosanna, but Hoshiana. So remember that for your personal devotions on Palm Sunday. The other Hebrew word is we sometimes refer to Yahweh, God as Yahweh. But a Hebrew scholar tells me that should be pronounced Yahweh. So again, you can go and impress members of other churches by saying to them, guess what we learned in Gurig Baptist Church? Just let me correct you on your Hebrew. Now, let's come together in prayer. Father, we remember today how our Lord Jesus Christ, our King, entered Jerusalem in quiet humility. Here indeed we see him taking the form of a servant, even to the point of death on a cross, emptying himself so that we might be filled. Come again now, Lord Jesus, and establish your kingdom in our hearts. Come afresh to our troubled world with all its needs and its tensions and its problems and its evil. Come again now and establish your kingdom here in our world. Bring healing where there is division. Bring love and inspire love where there is hatred. Bring hope where there is despair. Bring joy where there is fear. Bring strength where there is weakness. Bring healing where there is sickness. Bring life where there is death. Come now and establish your kingdom in our lives. Lord Jesus Christ, our King, reach out to your church and world. Despite the weakness of our faith and the rejection of so many, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We welcome you as our King. And we cry, Hosanna, come again now and establish your kingdom here among us in this place. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's go on and sing again together. And again, we'll stand as we sing.
Your glory veiled, not to
We read this morning from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 21, and we read from verse 1. Matthew, chapter 21, and we read from verse 1. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, tell him that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Jesus entered the temple area and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. "It is written," he said to them, "My house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers." The blind and the lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, and the children shouting in the temple area, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they were indignant. "Do you hear what these children are saying?" they asked him. "Yes," replied Jesus. "Have you never read, from the lips of children and infants, you have ordained praise?" And he left them and went out of the city to Bethany, where he spent the night. Amen. We thank God once again for his word. Now, Kenny is going to come and lead us in prayer.
Morning, everybody. As you know, our Lord encourages us to take any of our petitions, our thoughts, our concerns, our anxieties, for you, maybe yourself, or maybe your family, maybe your friends, or whatever. Can we just take a small moment just to do that individually? Heavenly Father, there's many things that troubled us in our personal lives. There may be other things who trouble us with our friends and our family. Lord, please draw near to us, and as we lay these at your feet. Lord, we think of the wider world and our troubled world at the moment, Lord, as we see tornadoes, war, famine, floods. Lord, we think also of the Christian work that goes on here with the aid and the humanitarian aid that goes on. Lord, please be with these folks, that folk may see the love of Christ, the love of you, Lord, that brings down barriers and makes us the people that we are. Lord, we ask for your strength as we look to our own community, our strength and be able to take Christ and be stalwarts for you, Lord, to preach and to pray and witness for you, Lord. Lord, there's many things in our community, whether it's drugs or where it is alcohol abuse or where it is domestic abuse, whatever, Lord, may we work with these people, and we think of all our street preachers and pastors and our fellow churches, Lord. Lord, may the love of Christ be seen once again here in Inverclyde. Lord, we think of our own church and the folks in our own church who are ill or infirmed, or who are anxious or concerned about health issues or other domestic issues. Lord, draw near to us and draw near to them and our friends and family. Lord, we ask for wisdom in this church as we look for a new pastor. We look for your guidance and for your intercession and us being able to take things forward. Lord, we thank you for the search committee, and for Stuart leading that, Lord, that you may guide us in the right way. Lord, we thank you for the many blessings that we have already received, and we pray that we may be strengthened in the days ahead. Lord, as always, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Prayer. Now we're going to sing of what a beautiful name Jesus has. We'll stand again to sing.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you separate.
If those who are serving would like to join me at the table. When Jesus rode into Jerusalem that day, nobody could doubt his humility. When he comes again, no one will doubt his majesty. I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and makes war. His eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Out of his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh, he has this name written: King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I wanted to read to you today the words of Robert Murray McShane, who was minister in Dundee. He wrote these words. They're difficult to read. O Christ, what burdens bowed thy head? Our load was laid on thee. Thou stoodest in the sinner's stead, didst bear all ill for me. A victim led, thy blood was shed. Now there's no load for me. Death and the curse were in our cup, O Christ. 'Twas full for thee, but thou hast drained the last dark drop. 'Tis empty now for me, that bitter cup. Love drank it up, now blessings draft for me. Jehovah lifted up his rod, O Christ, it fell on thee. Thou wast sore stricken of thy God. There's not one stroke for me. Thy tears, thy blood beneath it flowed. Thy bruising healeth me. The tempest's awful voice was heard. O Christ, it broke on thee. Thy open bosom was my ward that braved the storm for me. Thy form was scarred, thy visage marred. Thou cloudless peace for me. Jehovah bade his sword awake. O Christ, it woke against thee. Thy blood the flaming blade must slake. Thy heart its sheath must be. Oh, for my sake, my peace to make, now sleeps that sword for me. For me, Lord Jesus, thou hast died, and I have died in thee. Thou art risen, my bands are all untied. And now thou livest in me. When purified, made white and tried, thy glory then for me. We're going to give thanks for the bread and the cup. Let's pray together.
Lord and Heavenly Father, we come before you and just praise and honor your name. We ask you to bless this bread and wine. And as we share this communion time with each other, may we come closer to you, Father God. For you, Lord, took the sinless Christ and poured into him our sins. He willingly went to the cross at Calvary. He died in agony, lifted up, nailed to that cross where his blood was shed for us. Jesus is our Savior. He is the light of the world. May each one of us know him deep and intimately into the depth of our being, in a very personal, Christ-like way. Lord, we ask you to bless this bread and wine as we remember it's by his wounds we are healed. In Jesus' name, amen.
It was on the night when he was betrayed that Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, take and eat. This is my body broken for you. We eat as we receive. In the same way, Jesus took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. We hold the cup and drink together." We do this until he comes again. Now to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and has made us be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. We sing together such love, and we'll stand to sing. It's more difficult for us to appreciate the atmosphere that day when Jesus rode into Jerusalem than we imagine, I think. I know we've probably seen many reenactments of it, courtesy of television or Hollywood or whatever, with the crowds waving palm branches and shouting, but really nothing could ever adequately recapture the atmosphere of that first event. Just for one thing, no one expected or anticipated that Jesus was going to do this. It's only as they approach the city that the disciples are given the instructions to go and collect the donkey and its foal that Jesus would ride into the city on. So we can't imagine what it felt like or sounded like when those in the city saw Jesus riding down the Mount of Olives, looking for all the world like a king. There was all the potential there for serious unrest among the population. So if this had been anticipated, then I'm sure that the civil and religious authorities would have made the preparations beforehand to either prevent it or to strictly control it. So what must it have been like to have felt a hand on your shoulder and to have someone with the look of excitement in their eyes and the tone of excitement in their voice say to you, come and look at this. Come and see what's happening. What did it feel like to see Jesus arriving on a donkey, knowing that the Old Testament spoke of how the long-awaited, the long-promised king would arrive just like this? And to think to yourself, this is it. I've lived to see this day. We can't imagine what that felt like. Here comes the king, and with him all the hopes and dreams of a nation that felt rudderless, leaderless, directionless. So they welcomed him. Or at least the majority welcomed him. There were those who felt that this entrance was nothing more than mere exhibitionism by some pretender to the throne. And those who shouted and waved their palm branches would be judged as the uneducated mob, easily roused to excitement, easily manipulated, easily persuaded, easily pleased. And I'm sure there were those that day that did get lost in the excitement of it all. I'm sure that Jesus knew that too, and knew only too well the dangers of inciting tensions and inflaming emotions during Passover, because this was already a very highly charged date in the Jewish calendar. So he makes no rabble-rousing speeches to the crowds. He makes no attempt to make explicit what the manner of his arrival had made implicit. That here, Jerusalem, here is your king. But what did the crowds hear that day? You know how it's not what you say, it's what people hear that matters. You may say something and mean one thing, but people may hear you understand something else. And that remains an issue for people today when it comes to people today understand what God has been saying to the world for centuries, or do we hear just what we want to hear? On that first Palm Sunday, by arriving in the manner about who he was and why he had come, the statement he made that day still stands for us in our day, still stands for our generation. So what do we think Jesus was saying? Who do we think he is? Why do we think he came? To answer those kinds of questions, it will help us if we ask what that original Palm Sunday crowd thought they heard, what they thought they saw that day. When they saw Jesus arrive in Jerusalem in the guise of a king, they thought they saw the promise of a savior, someone who had come to rescue them. And they didn't know just how right they were. When they saw Jesus arrive in Jerusalem in the guise of a king, they thought they saw the promise of change. And they didn't know just how right they were. When they saw Jesus arrive in Jerusalem in the guise of a king, they thought they saw a promise of power. And they didn't know just how right they were. Yet while in one way Jesus would meet none of their expectations, in another way a far deeper, far, far more profound and more vital way, he would far exceed all their expectations. It's all a matter of understanding what God is doing. It's all a matter of listening to what God is saying and has been saying for centuries. First of all, when the crowd saw Jesus arrive in Jerusalem in the guise of a king, they thought they saw the promise of a savior, someone who had come to rescue them, and they didn't know just how right they were. They wanted political freedom. They didn't want to have to pay income tax and VAT and inheritance tax and so on to Caesar any longer. They didn't want their streets policed by Roman soldiers any longer. They didn't want foreign laws to take precedence over their own laws. They wanted independence. And to get their independence, they needed a savior. They needed a rescuer. They needed a king. But Jesus hadn't come to give his life to fighting for their rights. He had come to give his life as a sacrifice for our sins. There was a far deeper freedom that Jesus wanted to bring. For years, these people that cheered Jesus into Jerusalem had lived with the understanding that when you did something wrong, you had to make amends, and that meant making an offering or a sacrifice to God for your sin. Leviticus chapter 16 details one of the most solemn of all the Old Testament sacrifices. It was the sin offering as designed by God. For this occasion, which happened only once a year, all the tribes of Israel were to attend. Two goats were selected and presented to God as a sacrifice for the nation's sin. One of the goats was to be slaughtered on the altar, and the other was to become the scapegoat that would carry away the people's sins. The first of the goats is taken and slaughtered as a sacrifice on the altar. Then the high priest stands before the second goat, and he lays his hands on its head. And the ceremony is quite specific. He is to lay both hands on the head of the live goat and confess over it all the wickedness and rebellion of the Israelites, all their sins, and put them on the goat's head. He shall send the goat away into the desert in the care of a man appointed for the task. The goat will carry on itself all their sins to a solitary place, and the man shall release it in the desert. Watching the first goat die and watching the scapegoat bearing the sins of the nation being led away into the desert must have felt a powerful demonstration of the seriousness of our sin and of God's determination to deal with our sin, and especially his wish to remove it altogether, to see it taken away. Every year the nation would watch the performing of that ceremony, knowing that they were personally involved in it because it was their sin, that a price was being paid for. Generation after generation of people watched for thousands of years, never realizing that the fate of those two goats was a foreshadowing, indeed a promise, of what Jesus Christ would one day come and do for the sins of the world. That annual ceremony of the sin offering was like the drawings of an architect's plans. When he's asked to design a house, the architect will put down on paper what the house will look like: living room, bedrooms, kitchen, and so on. The new owner can look at the plans and can look forward to the plans becoming reality, taking shape in bricks and mortar. The owner doesn't want to live with just the plans for his new home. He wants to live in the house. Just so the sin ceremony involving the goats was like an architect's plans of what was yet to come. And there was so much more to come. One day, Jesus Christ would come and die for the sins of the world, and in dying, he would bear our sins away once and for all, once and for all. That's why he's the Savior of the world. As they entered Jerusalem that day to the cries of Hosanna, save us, which is what it means, the crowd was asking him to save them from their political enemies, from the burden of foreign taxes and foreign laws. But Jesus had a great deal more than that in view. He wanted to save us from the burden of our sin, which brings misery through bad habits and harmful addictions and fears and self-destructive behavior and complexes, and results in the death of the body and the soul. Yes, he's come to be a savior. Yes, he's come to rescue us. but far beyond our expectations and imagining. He's come so that we might be forgiven and that our sins might be taken away, and there is no one else that can do that for us. Secondly, when they saw Jesus arrive in Jerusalem in the guise of a king, they thought they saw the promise of change. And they didn't realize just how right they were. When a business gets a new boss, people expect it will be all change. And they're probably right. Hopefully, it will be change for the better, although that's not always necessarily the case. When the crowd saw Jesus entering Jerusalem, as they did, they must have thought he was coming to change things. Why make this kind of entrance if that wasn't the case, if you weren't coming to do that? He could have arrived as tens of thousands of other pilgrims arrived quietly, unnoticed, causing no stir or commotion. But to enter the city like a king was always going to bring with it a wind of change, either for good or ill. However, the change that Jesus had in mind was much deeper, much more profound than anything anyone else had in mind. The change that Jesus has in mind for us is a change of mind and a change of heart that leads to a change of direction in life. It's what the Bible calls repentance. One trademark, if you like, of Jesus' ministry was that he called people to follow him. That was life-changing for people. For James and John and Peter and Andrew, it meant leaving their fishing business behind. For Matthew, it meant leaving his profitable accounting business behind. And for some people, it was just too much to leave behind. Jesus looked at him and loved him. One thing you lack, he said. Go, sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. The challenge to change is a very serious one, can be very costly, and yet Jesus never hesitated to call people to repent, to leave their life of sin behind and to come, follow me. Boy, how his eyes must have shone when he said that to people. Come, follow me. I think one mistake people make today is that we confuse repentance with regret. What's the difference? It's easy to think that when we decide to follow Jesus, it's enough to just feel sorry for our sins and ask him to forgive us. If we just feel sorry that we've not been as generous or as gracious or as faithful or as kind or as patient or as loyal as we know deep down we ought to have been in, we ask God to forgive us for being like that, then we can be forgiven. Promise to try harder in the future. Job done. But regret isn't repentance. Regret is only one part of repentance. Jesus doesn't call us to regret our sins, but to repent of our sins. And to repent means leaving your old self behind and working with God to make a new self in the likeness of Jesus Christ. I always despair when I hear a Christian say after they've done something or said something that as a Christian they shouldn't have done or said, they'll say, oh, well, you know, that's just me. That's just me. You'll just have to take it or leave it just the way I am. Take me or leave me. So what happened to that person when they became a Christian? What ought to have happened is what Paul says. If anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old has gone. The new has come. Right. And if you'd like to ask Paul to be more specific about that, okay, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Right, Paul, got you. Got where you're going. You were taught with regard to your former way of life, to put off your old self, which has been corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Okay, Paul, I'm getting the message. I see where you're going with it. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor. For we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. Do not give the devil a foothold. I'm getting the picture. He who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Are you finished, Paul? Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Whew. Is that specific enough? If the crowd that welcomed Jesus that day imagined for a moment that he was coming to make a difference only to their nation, and that he would make no personal demands upon them, they were seriously disappointed. He comes to call us to follow him, and he means to challenge us and to make us face radical change within. Finally, when they saw Jesus arrive in Jerusalem in the guise of a king, they thought they saw the promise of power. And they didn't know just how right they were. I don't know how familiar you are with the story of Naaman from the Old Testament. Naaman was a very important and powerful man, but he had a terrible skin disease. He was told that God could cure him. And he went off to see the prophet Elisha, who sent a messenger to tell Naaman that he needed to go and wash in the River Jordan to be cured. But Naaman went away angry and said, I thought that he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the spot and cure me of my leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than any of the waters of Israel? Couldn't I wash in them and be cleansed? So he turned and went off in a rage. The problem was that God hadn't told Elisha to treat Naaman with due pomp and circumstance. If God had told Elisha to go and cure Naaman through performing some elaborate ceremony, that would have been seen as befitting a man of such importance. But to tell him to go and wash in a river. Eventually, though, Naaman is persuaded to do as Elisha says, and he's cured. Sometimes God's power is displayed in the most simple, the most ordinary, the most commonplace of events or places or people. That's why God's greatest demonstration of power is to be seen in a man dying on a cross outside Jerusalem's city walls on what had become the town's rubbish tip. But if God was going to save the world, couldn't he have done better than that? No. Those who welcomed Jesus into Jerusalem that day thought that here was the promise of kingly power. And they weren't wrong. But what did they think when a week later that same promise of power appeared to be broken upon that cross? If the world then and the world today thinks that believing in a man who died a criminal's death 2,000 years ago is a waste of time, then people need to think again. All that Jesus promised that day, he entered Jerusalem on a donkey. That here was God's appointed and anointed king who can change the world by changing people's lives, because he has the power to do that, is undeniably true. And it's still true today. It's still true for you. And it's still true for me. Thank God. Let's sing together. Thank you.
share. Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Are we weak and heavy laden, cumbered with a load of care? Precious Savior, still our refuge. Despise, forsake thee, take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee, thou wilt find a solace there.
Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honour and glory forever and ever. Amen.
May God's blessings surround.